number 334 in your hymn books, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Number 334. Number 340, he hideth my soul. Number 340.
Hi. Happy Mother's Day to all you mothers out there. I want to say that God knew what He was doing when He gave us mothers, because there is no love quite like a mother can give you. Would everybody agree? Let us pray. Father, thank You for this day that You've allowed us once again to come into Your house and worship You. And God, I thank You for the wonderful blessing that You have given us with our mothers. And God, I thank You that You have given them the ability to love and nurture us through anything that happens in our lives. And God, I ask You just to be with us through the course of this service. God, I ask You to be with Brother Matthew as he brings the message. I ask You to just to help us open up our hearts and our minds and receive that message and apply it to our lives. And God, if there is one here that does not know You as their personal Savior, I ask that today would be the hour that they'd accept You. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Stand, turn around, shake hands as they play "The Bond of Love." leads us all. Sing it together. We are one in the bond of love. We are one in the bond of love. We have joined our spirit with the Spirit of God. We are one in the bond of love. Let us sing now.
Our ushers come forward for our offering this morning. Johnny, will you pray for us?
Father, thank you again, Lord, for giving this opportunity to come to you. God, this is a special day, Lord. Just remember each and every activity we have planned today. God, just be with our preaching, Lord. Be with our pastor as he stands before us. Lord, just use us with the people that's here, Lord. If there's anybody lost and undone without you, let this be the day that they receive you into their heart. Use us, Lord, throughout this week, Lord, and just as you see fit, bless this offering to this church and to you for your needs. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Life for mine. me healing. He spilled his blood to fill my soul. His crown of thorns made me royalty. His sorrow gave me joy untold. His life for mine. His life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die? God's son would die to save a wretch like me. What love divine, he gave his life for mine. He was despised and rejected, stripped of his garment and oppressed. I am loved and accepted, and I wear a robe of righteousness. His life for mine. His life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die? God's son would die to save a wretch like me. What love divine, he gave his life for mine.
Amen. Thank you, Christy. As we begin this morning, if you look in your bulletin, I have an outline, and those are healthy things for me to have, so we're not just randomly talking all the time. But this morning, if you notice, there's not a particular scripture that I'm pointing you to, and the reason for that is because we're really going to do a lot of bouncing around, more than I normally do, and so. If I'm going to try to say the scriptures so you can at least write them down, but I don't know that you'll have necessarily time to turn to all of them. So just bear with me as we're looking at that. If you want to have your finger somewhere, we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 through 4 quite a bit. So eventually we'll get there. It's not where I'm going first, but if you want to go ahead and turn there. And the other place you can kind of have your finger is Deuteronomy chapter 6. So Ephesians chapter 6 and Deuteronomy chapter 6. But I'm going to start this morning in Genesis. Like I said, as the service was starting, that God is the one who created the family. I think that's really important. In a lot of ways in our society today, we're wanting to break the family apart. We're trying to turn it into either an individualistic life that everyone just lives their own thing and has no connection with anyone else, or we're all in this sort of big, that everything's equal. There is not this unit anymore that used to be a husband and a wife, which is the foundation of the family. And I just want to show you from Scripture that when God designed the way we were to live together, this is the way He designed it. In Genesis chapter 2, verses 21 through 24, So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to man. Then man said, This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Just very quickly, I want to make a quick explanation. I don't know if you have little tangents that you go when you're interested in thinking, but one of the places that's bothered me for a long time is, what is the significance of the rib? What's that about? And I've heard sermons about how the rib protects your heart, and so in the same way woman protects man's heart, and there's some really interesting stuff, but really, what is it saying? I just want to kind of throw this out there. In Hebrew, the word rib is the same as the word side. So if I were to say, come stand by my side, in Hebrew I would say, come stand by my rib, and everyone understood the rib is the side. So there is a sense in what this is teaching us right off the bat, is that when God made Eve for Adam, she was made to be by his side. She was a part of his side. She was beside him. And so God ordained not only this relationship, but even what that relationship would look like. Jesus would later comment on this in Matthew chapter 19, verse 6. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let man not separate. And I thought it would be appropriate as we look at Mother's Day, and as I was thinking about what is it that I should bring from God's Word having to do with motherhood and all that it means, I wanted to start with saying motherhood starts with family. And it starts with a relationship between a husband and a wife. And so for those of you that are married this morning, I want to encourage you right off the bat to strive for your marriage. Jan and I had a long conversation this week that there is, I don't know why you think life gets easier. Did anyone tell you that things get easier as you get older? I cannot think of a single thing in my life that has gotten easier as I've gotten older. And so marriage is in that category. Marriage is one of those things that as you walk through life, don't think that if you've been married 10 years, that means your marriage is so much easier than it was when you were married 5 years. And now I'm starting to really understand why we celebrate so much when someone has a 40th wedding anniversary. Because it's not that marriage has gotten easier. It's that they're continuing to work on it. For 40 years, 50 years, 60 years. And I just want to encourage you, if you feel like your marriage is not where you want it to be, that's life. Just keep going. Don't give up. Don't quit. Keep working on it. So that's the first thing, is that God is the one who made the family, and it starts with a marriage between a husband and a wife. And then also with children, and just so you get a flavor of that, don't try to keep up with me. I'm going to go really quick here, but in Genesis chapter 4, verse 1, now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. Here's what happened. The Bible explains to us that it was not a miraculous birth. There was a baby for a reason, and he explains the reason. And if you're old enough to understand, you can read it. And it says very clearly why there's a baby. But immediately, Eve recognizes that the baby did not come because of the action, but it came as a gift of the Lord. She recognized that the child's conception and birth was because God helped her. And she's not the only one. I could give you a lot of examples, but just two others. Sarah, in Genesis 21, says this. Well, the Bible says that the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah as he had promised, and Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age at the time of which God had spoken to him. Again, it was because the Lord visited Sarah, and the Lord did to Sarah that there was a baby. There is no baby born that God is not the reason the baby is born. That's why we care so much about abortion.
It doesn't matter that there was a mistake or there was an evil action or whatever. It doesn't matter. Because a baby doesn't come because of the actions of men alone. A baby comes because God brings the baby about. That's why. It also happened in Hannah's life. If you want to read about it, it's in 1 Samuel chapter 1, and you'll read the same thing. And so God establishes a marriage between a husband and wife, and God establishes children. Every one of you is born because God created you. That's why. And it's important that we realize that. And we're a blessing. Psalms 127 verse 3 says, "Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb, a reward." And those of us that have children, we are blessed because of our children. Being a mother and being a father is a blessing from the Lord. Secondly, I want to encourage you, in your bulletin, there's a blank. And it says, blank are to teach your children. You might be thinking, well, it's Mother's Day, so we must be going, mothers are to teach your children, but I'm not. Matter of fact, I really debated about which word. So I want you to put parents in the blank. Parents are to teach your children. But right next to it, I want you to write fathers in parentheses. Because I want to show you something interesting. As I was looking for verses to talk about a mother's job in raising their children, what I found was a whole lot more verses talking about fathers raising your children. So I'm going to say something that might sound, I'll just go ahead and say it. You as parents are the ones who are responsible for your children. You are. You're responsible for their education. And by the way, I think it's a very wise move as a parent to send your children to school so that teachers can teach them. But never let you think that they're the ones who are responsible for your children's education. You still are. You are responsible for your children's education. You're responsible for their spiritual education, not the church. Again, I don't know that it's been preached this way, but I think in our heads, we think you bring your children to church and drop them off and they'll teach them about God. But I want to show you this morning, I'm going to take just a few minutes and show you from Scripture. And the first place I want you to look at in Exodus, God is about to rescue His people. There have been 9 plagues, and the Pharaoh has said, no, 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 9 times. And finally, after all of that, God says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to get ready for the Passover. So get the lamb, get the leaven, and there's several chapters devoted to preparing for this night when the death angel would come and kill all of the firstborn that were not protected by the blood. And there was a picture of Christ right there in the middle of it. And as that happens in Exodus, chapter 12, verse 24, God tells Moses to tell the people, "You shall observe this rite as a statute for you and for your sons forever. And when you come to the land that the Lord will give you, as He has promised, you shall keep this service. And when your children say, 'What do you mean by this service?' you shall say, 'It is a sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, for He passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians but spared our houses.' And the people bowed their heads and worshipped." Do you understand why the Passover was set up? The Passover was a holiday that they would celebrate forever. They are still celebrating it. Matter of fact, we do too, although we use a different name now, for the same event. That because of the blood, our sins were passed over, and those who deserved to die would not have to die. We celebrate Easter, same time of year, and it's a continuation of that holiday. And here's what God tells Moses to tell the people. When your son asks why you're doing that, you, not the pastor, not the priest, nobody else. You are to be celebrating this holiday, and you are to teach your children why it is that you're doing it. So at the very beginning of the Israel nation, God was telling His people, it is the job of the parents to teach your children what it is that you believe. To explain to them, this is why we do this. On Christmas, this is why we open presents. on Easter. This is why we celebrate Easter. And then in Proverbs chapter 4, Proverbs is written by Solomon. And there's at least a portion of it, it appears as if he's writing to his son. In Proverbs chapter 4, he says this, "Hear, O sons, a father's instruction, and be attentive, that you may gain insight, for I give you good precepts. Do not forsake my teaching. When I was a son with my father, tender, the only one in the sight of my mother, he taught me and said to me, 'Let your heart hold fast my words, keep my commandments and live. Get wisdom, get insight, do not forget, and do not turn away from the words of my mouth.'" I want to say this as clearly as I possibly can. Today is Mother's Day. We're celebrating all that mothers do. This is a big holiday in general for fathers. Because if we have little kids, it's our job to make sure the little kids have bought their Mother's Day present, right? And so what I want to do this morning is I want to turn the spotlight on the fathers. Fathers, if you want to honor your wife, if you want to support her as a mother the way she needs to be supported, by the authority of Scripture, teach your children. And I'm saying that very clearly because I think in this culture, we have surrendered rearing kids to women. We've said, mothers, it's your job. You're the spiritual leaders. You're the one who does the teaching. And the Bible is very clear that it is the fathers who are responsible. When I stand before God, and my children's lives are brought before me, the Lord will not say, "Well, you know, your wife really could have done a better job." That is not the conversation that we'll have. I will be judged by my actions for what I have done as a father to raise my children to understand who the Lord is. Now, their decision is their own. Okay? And there is forgiveness in Christ. But don't let that move you from understanding that as fathers, we are called to be the spiritual leaders of our home. We are called to teach. If you have your fingers in Ephesians chapter 6, let's look there. This is one of the first verses we try to get children to memorize, and it's a good one for them to know. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may live long in the land. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. It is very clear there. It does not say parents. Okay, now I'm not diminishing. In chapter 31 of Proverbs, we read that Solomon learned a lot from his mother. I can show you several other passages where I'm going to read one in just a second about mothers. But just to be clear, in Ephesians chapter 6, Paul tells fathers, you are the one to bring them up. In the Lord, you are the one to bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. And let me just break those two words down for you very quickly. Discipline, literally in Greek, means to make the mind bow down. Discipline starts with submission. And that happens in my own... Think about one of the worst things I'm not disciplined about is eating. What I have to learn to do to diet is to bow my mind to my just whatever it is I'm supposed to be doing. Does that make sense? If you're going to train in a sport, discipline is about training your mind to submit to what it is you want to do, to make your body submit to what it is you want to do. And we are called by God to discipline our children. Of all the reasons that I like for my children to be in church on Sunday morning, one of the reasons is I want them to learn to be quiet before the Lord, The Lord's voice is a quiet voice. How can they learn to hear the Lord unless they've learned to be quiet? And so that's what it's about. It's not showing off, and it's not checking a box. It's not for any other reason. I want them to hear from God. And the way for them to hear from God is to be disciplined enough to hear from them. And so fathers are to discipline their children. That's the word discipline. And the word instruction means to teach, to show them what's right, to admonish, to say, this is the right way. And that's the other thing that we're called to do. And so, and just as an encouragement, let me, in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, Paul's talking to Timothy and encouraging him. He says, I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt at first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. There are some that are probably here this morning that are having to raise their children on their own, that they don't have a father who is going to be the spiritual leader. And yet we see Timothy, who is a great leader of the church. Matter of fact, I think he was an apostle. I think there's reason to say that Timothy was one of the apostles. And yet in Timothy's life, he came to Christ through the teaching of his mother and his grandmother. Okay, so don't be discouraged. But those of you that are men, that are fathers here, step up. Be the man that God has called you to be, and that looks like disciplining and instructing your children to bring them up in the Lord. This morning, we're going to do a dedication service. In just a minute, I'm going to have the Settlemyers come forward, and they're going to dedicate their son this morning. And as we get ready to do that, this is what they're talking about doing. There is no promise that you do this, this, and this, and this will happen. This is not some sort of salvation that's going to occur yet. What it is saying that as parents, they are preparing to be committed to bringing their son up so that he will know Christ. And that we as a church, although we are not the ones who are responsible, we as a church are going to stand with them and help them and support them. And what it is that they're doing, and we get to take part. So I'm going to go ahead and ask them to come forward this morning. And as they're coming, as we do a children's dedication, what we're doing is we're declaring three truths about the human condition. The first one is that young people are created in the image of God. And that they are they belong to Him. And secondly, we recognize that even though babies are beautiful and they're fun and they're exciting and they're cute, that they're also born with a sinful nature, that on their own, their eternity is not solid because of the decisions that they make. And thirdly is that Jesus is the one who is the rescuer, that He's the one who delivers these children. And what we're asking is that the Lord would be working in Hayes' life this morning. So I'm going to ask you some questions. I'll hand you the mic so you can speak into it. So I'm going to ask you some questions, and if you will, you answer with "we will." So, do you here this day recognize your child as the gift of God and give heartfelt thanks to God's blessings?
We will.
Do you here this day dedicate your child to the Lord who gave him?
We do.
We do.
And do you here this day pledge as parents that you will bring up your child in the discipline and instruction of the Lord?
We do.
Do you here this day promise to give your child every possible benefit of home, of education, and of the church?
We do.
And do you here this day ask God's blessing upon your child's life to guide, guard, and direct your child through all his years?
We do.
And what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask the grandparents to stand. So Peggy and Johnny and Diane is here as well. And y'all are a second set of parents who are also. And so I'm not going to repeat these pledges individually, but I'm going to ask you as grandparents, are you also willing to help them? Okay, and now what I want to do is I want to ask the whole church to stand. Will you, members of Laurel Bank, be faithful to your calling as members of the body of Christ so that these children and all other children in your midst may grow up in the knowledge and love of Him? Amen. Will you? Amen. Let's pray. Lord, may your name be glorified. And Lord, we pray this morning for Hayes specifically that in due time, Lord, that you would stir his heart, that he would understand you, that he would love you, that he would serve you with all that he has. And I pray that you would give his parents wisdom and discernment as they raise him. Lord, be glorified in their lives and in his life. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I've got a Bible to give you. Congregation, you may be seated.
Thank you.
Amen. And I'm telling you, church, there is nothing more we can be doing as God's people than raising our children to love and serve God. May we be faithful to doing that. And I've got one more point if you look in the outline. And as you parents are continuing your job, and some of you have already got there, the last point I want to make is the goal of parenting is to raise children. I know that sounds a little obvious, but you know, I've met a lot of adults that I'm not sure were raised. And I think sometimes, and mothers, I think this is a challenge for you in particular, we have a tendency to wish that our children could stay children forever. Listen, your job is for your children to be an adult. That's the goal. And don't ever lose sight of that. Don't ever get so caught up with how wonderful it feels to be important that you lose the sight of that what it is you're doing as a parent is you're raising them to be adults. Again, in Ephesians, we're told that that we are to raise our children in discipline and in instruction. I'm in Deuteronomy. No wonder. I was like, man, that does not look like Ephesians at all. Normally, I'm... Amen. Amen. Bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. And what is successful for us as parents is when our children stand before God as adults serving Him. That's what it looks like for successful parents. And again, God is the one who brings the increase, okay? So if you have children and they're not doing that, they make their own decisions. They are their own adults. But if, as a parent, when I'm praying for my children, I'm not praying that they'll remain my children forever. I'm praying for their marriages. I'm praying for their ministries. I'm praying that God would use them for His kingdom as they grow. That's what I want them to be. Okay. In the other thing we're going to do this morning is we're going to honor some graduates. We have some that have graduated high school and college as well this morning. And what I want to do, I'm going to go ahead and those of you that like to come forward, you can. Let's go ahead and come forward. And we have a gift for you that we'd like to give you. But I want to do a little bit of a challenge to the church before we do that. And here's the challenge. One of the worst things we can do to young adults is treat them as if they're still children. And so I want you as a church to make a commitment with me that we're going to use this morning's time as a transition. Okay? I'm not going to refer to these young people as kids anymore. And I'm going to ask you not to do that either. They are adults. They're ready to live their life. They've achieved accomplishments and they're moving forward. And what we need to do this morning is we need to recognize them for who they are as adults. You don't like me behind you? Jake's getting to know me pretty well. And to you as graduates, I have a couple of verses I want to read for you. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11 says, "When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways." And what you need to do as graduates is to recognize you're adults. So just like I'm telling the congregation, they need to treat you like adults, I want to tell you, you need to be adults. Grow up. And it's a good thing. We are praising God for what He's doing in your life. In 1 Corinthians 14, verse 20, "Brothers, do not be children in your thinking, be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. In your thoughts, grow up, be mature." And finally, just as a reminder to the church and a reminder to all of us, in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 15, he talks about giving different jobs within the church. He says, "And I gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry." In other words, there are those in leadership. Their job is to equip the saints, that's everyone who's saved, for the work of the ministry. And here's what the work of the ministry is: for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the full of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ. Here's what this says. We as a congregation, not just those in leadership, but we as the saints of God, are to be equipping the body to be mature. And what that looks like in maturity is that we're no longer tossed by the wind. So as a church, we're presenting some resources to the graduates. Brady is, matter of fact, let's go ahead and do this, and I'll introduce everyone. if you will, say your name, say what it is you're graduating from, and where you're going next.
For the three of you that don't know, I'm Brady Nelms, and I'm graduating from UT. I'm taking a year off, perhaps a sabbatical. I'm actually scheduled to visit some open houses at different seminaries in the fall to look at pursuing perhaps first a Master's of Divinity and then moving forward from there.
My name's Lexi Tring. I'm graduating from William Blount, and I'm going to MTSU and hopefully going to further move on and get my doctorate in psychology.
Hang on a second. All right. My name's Clayton Tipton. I'm graduating from William Blount, and I'm planning on going to college for computer programming.
My name's Taylor Perkins. I'm graduating from William Blount, and I plan on going to college in the Air Force and then teaching history.
Well, I guess we saved the best for last, right? My name's Jake Pennington. What school did I graduate from? Penn Foister. I graduated from Penn Foister High School. It's an online school. And I'm planning on going to be a diesel mechanic, but I haven't made it there yet. Amen. So, thank you all. Amen. There you go. You made me talk.
So, each of them has a plan. Each of you have a plan. And it's hopefully a plan that the Lord has ordained, that what you're doing is you're following the Lord's will in these things. And as we just read, what we're saying, maturity, what manhood looks like in God, is that you're not swayed to and fro. When you get out into the world, there's going to be people who are wanting you to believe one thing or wanting you to be another. And so from the church, what we're giving you for those that are graduating high school is a study Bible. So we pray that this will be something that you're able to use. It's got notes and maps and concordances and a lot of things that we pray will be helpful in becoming mature in Christ. And then for Brady, he already had a study Bible, so he's getting a Strong's Concordance and Vine's Dictionary. Hopefully that'll help him as he gets ready to start seminary and having some resources. Here's the point. As a church, we are supporting them to become mature. Whatever that looks like. And Jake, I'll use you as an example. The Lord can do mighty things with a diesel mechanic who loves the Lord and follows Him. There are people He can preach to that no one else can preach to. Taylor, there will be people that as a history teacher you can reach that no one else can reach. And that's true with every one of us. As we pursue the Lord, what it is we're doing is we're serving where the Lord has placed us. You may be seated, and I won't. Congratulations. As we close this morning, I want this to be a sending out time. So as we stand to sing our invitation, those of us that have parents, maybe you want to bring your children to the altar and pray. And again, there's no magic about these carpeted steps. But just as a commitment that you are going to raise your children with discipline and with instruction that they would know the Lord. Maybe it's you as adults, you realize that what was just said to the graduates should be said to you, that you need to grow up. You need to be mature in Christ. That you need to serve Him with everything and quit being driven by this wind and that wind, backward and forward. Maybe you're here and you look at a church that is wanting to support some people and you say, you know, I want to be part of that. I want to join with the church so that we together can be part of the saints of God who are bringing about the maturity in others. Whatever the Lord moves in your heart to do, I want you to be obedient to Him. So let's stand and let's sing this morning.
Have you failed in your plan of your storm-tossed life? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Are you weary and worn from its toil and strife? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand.
On Wednesday night, we are, for the next few weeks, going to be looking at Psalm 67. What I'm going to do is I'm going to conclude today's service with this prayer. It's what it is. For those of you that weren't there we're going to spend some weeks on this, and although there won't be a test at the end, we're encouraging each other to memorize this psalm. There's seven verses, and I just want to challenge you to memorize it. We're probably going to do some things in the service in the next few weeks to try to help with that. But what I'm going to do is, this will be our final benediction this morning. This is a prayer, and it's a blessing. So let's pray. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make His face to shine upon us, that Your way may be known on earth, Your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise You, O God. Let all the peoples praise You. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for You judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise You, O God. Let all the peoples praise You. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear Him. Amen.